right, welcome everyone for this week's Rising Tide Foundation Sunday lecture. Very, very happy today that we have Anton once again with us to present a bunch of mind-blowing ideas. I know this happens every single time, so I'm not going to spoil anything. All I can say is that Anton has already published volume one of two of Who We Are, America's Fight for Universal Progress from Franklin to Kennedy. And this volume is a mind blower. If you don't have this already, I suggest go out, buy it. I'm talking to everybody also listening online in the future on YouTube and other platforms. A lot of the most beautiful discoveries that have been suppressed regarding how the leap beyond our limits to growth has actually occurred in such a way that America has become such a driving force, not only for progress throughout the 19th century into the 20th century, but also one of the greatest nightmares of the oligarchy for a reason. There's something very beautiful, although a lot of people, especially internationally here, I live in Canada, a lot of people in Europe, they have a difficulty seeing this more positive, brilliant side of America, which has to be told. If the US is going to be able to survive the current storm and also avoid World War III, it'll be because certain facts of history will be rediscovered and acted upon in a very close future. So I won't say anything more than that, except to say that Anton is in the midst of producing volume two. It's quickly coming online. It'll be, I think you have the focus deadline, Anton, next year in June, right? For the publishing date?
Yeah, okay. That's right.
And there's a GoFundMe as well to help support that project. I'm going to make that link available.
It didn't start yet.
Oh, what is it called?
It didn't start yet.
Oh, it didn't start. It will start soon. Yeah. So people will be able to help that project along. And when that's available, we'll make that easily available for people to help out with. Today, we're going to learn a lot about some lesser appreciated, but extremely important sides of Lincoln's battles on various fronts throughout the Civil War, probably a little bit before and during. And some personalities who probably you never even heard of before, but you should. So you should know much more about. So Anton, thank you once again. For anybody who has a question at the end, please just put your name in the chat box and I'll call upon you like usual in queue. It's all yours, Anton.
Okay, good morning or good afternoon. I guess it's morning and somewhere. I want to tell you a bit about things that I'm studying now and trying to get certain about the truth and make it plain to people what actually happened about things that are paradoxical and embarrassing to enemies of progress, but will be beautiful, inspiring, and funny to people who are friends of progress. So today I want to go through a little bit of the chapter four that I'm writing. It's called Lincoln versus the Money Power, and chapter five, which is agricultural reform, why farmers fought for the People's Department. And then those two are the first two out of three chapters for the Lincoln administration. The next one would be the railroad, the Transcontinental Railroad. And then I have six other chapters that are both in the Lincoln administration and afterwards by individuals that are not as well known, but give you a real, detailed and dynamic idea of the battle going on and the creativity of the best Americans. And also in every case, the paradox of doing good, which is that human beings are flawed, the best of us, and the worst of us are human. And so there's some tremendous paradoxes, which I want to get into especially slavery, which comes up very strongly in the chapter on agriculture. So Lincoln was inaugurated in March 1861, and the Capitol soon came under siege. A month after he was inaugurated, the attack occurred on Fort Sumter. And the South already had mobilized troops. The United States had only 3,000 soldiers available on the East Coast, total of 15,000, most out West, and no money. Previous administrations had bankrupted the country and left it open to complete destruction. So when Lincoln called for volunteers and asked Congress to produce an army of 400,000 men and appropriate $400 million, there were no hundreds of millions of dollars to do what was needed. There was a plan to create a new national banking system, but this was it was going to take a long time to get that together and to get agreement on it, especially since the state chartered banks, which included the New York and Boston oligarchy, were opposed to it. They were able to get legislation through better than they had been able to, because the Southern members of Congress had left. Now all they had to deal with were Northern Democrats and the bankers' wing of the Republican Party. So what were they going to do to pay for the soldiers? They had to pay suppliers and soldiers, and they couldn't get this banking reform passed for really a couple of years. So as an emergency measure, it was proposed in Congress in accord with the thinking of the best strategists like Henry Carey, that the United States Treasury should print notes that would be declared legal tender for all purposes and could circulate as money. These would not have any interest. They would be printed and paid to the soldiers and for other things that the government needed. Can you put up on the screen the picture of Spaulding, Elbridge Spaulding? Oh no, first do the greenbacks. I'm sorry, go back. Do the greenbacks. Sorry for the makeshift illustrations. I just put this together at the last minute. So these are, there you see a $10 note and a $5 note and the back of a 20. The back of these notes were printed in green. They usually didn't have anything printed on the back of a treasury note. So these were called greenbacks. And what was unusual about them is that they were not supported by gold. There was no gold promised to pay the person. You couldn't cash it in for gold. You could cash it in for a government bond. They were called legal tender notes. It said on there that it was legal tender, and it had to be accepted by people. If you gave it to somebody, the law said they should accept this as money. Now, the country had had a very bad experience with notes like that. In the American Revolution, the Continental Congress, representing not a government, but just a revolutionary force and some states that were loosely confederated, Continental Congress issued notes that said they would pay the person who cashed it in, they would pay them in gold. I think it was after a while. But there was no gold for them to pay, and they had no means of getting any gold or any production, really. Country was backward and in chaos from the war. So these notes back, the Continental notes, had depreciated terribly and became more or less worthless. So this was a bitter memory, and this was something that other countries had also, memory of worthless, what's called fiat currency, where the government simply creates currency and says, this is money, and has nothing to back it up. Now, do you need something to back up your currency? Yes. Otherwise, that's what happens to it. It depreciates, people won't accept it. Now, give me the picture of Spalding. This is a congressman from upstate New York, Elbridge Gerry Spalding, who wrote a wonderful book of the history of the legal tender notes, or the Legal Tender Act. He wrote this years later, but it had a complete record of the fight over this thing in the Congress. So these are the green, when it was passed finally, these are the greenbacks that you've heard so much about. And later there was a fight about keeping them in circulation. So while this law to issue such notes was being it was about to be introduced, I think it had been introduced in a committee that he was the chairman of, the subcommittee on this kind of thing. The New York bankers heard about it. Now let's get the picture of James Gallatin. There he is. So this gentleman is the son of Albert Gallatin, who was Treasury Secretary for two presidents, Jefferson and Madison. His father was from Geneva, Switzerland, and in a sense had dual citizenship. I don't know the formal details of that, but they maintained their home in Geneva, and that's where he retired to later on, this James, the son. He was from his teenage years, a full partner of his father, and succeeded his father as a private banker in New York after his father had been Treasury Secretary. Geneva, Switzerland, and this family, being a patrician aristocratic family from Geneva, Geneva is the center. It was called the Protestant Rome. It was the center of Calvinism. James Calvin was from there. And Geneva and Amsterdam were twin centers for imperial, not only investment and activity and intrigues, but the philosophy that man is not on this earth to do good, that evil is justified by the gods. And really, this is not a Christian doctrine. It would, however they used Calvin, and however many Presbyterians and Calvinists were actually true Christians and good people, in Geneva, they used this philosophy to go back to the ancient dark philosophies that justified conquest. So you have an Anglo-Dutch monetary system in the world, And Geneva is one of the centers of creating that and sharing in the power of it, even though it's a small place. Gallatin was one of the leading families of there. And when this family were considered like royalty among the elite of the world. So James Gallatin, this gentleman, was probably the most important and prestigious banker in New York City when the Civil War began. In 1859, can you put up his pamphlet on Gallatin on usury? That's okay. There he is. So in 1859, James Gallatin made a speech that was turned into a pamphlet, and he was defending the idea that usury was good. The occasion for this was that and usury means charging too high an interest rate or illegally high interest rate, but the deeper and historic meaning of the word is the abuse of governments and individuals by bankers and money lenders who have the power of blackmail and political power. That's usury. There had been just put into circulation a book at that time in the 1850s attacking Jeremy Bentham, the old British economist. Put up the Bentham pamphlet now. Bentham back around.
Is that the one you just?
Yeah, it's the last thing I sent you. Yeah.
All right, that'll take 30 seconds.
Okay. Jeremy Bentham published a pamphlet back in the 1780s called Defense of Usury. And this was promoted by the Gallatin family, by Albert Gallatin and his circle of Geneva people. Bentham was an intermediary between the British government and the spies and intriguers in Geneva and in revolutionary France. So this is a big story on its own. But anyway, so if you have that pamphlet, this is something
unfortunately,
that
unfortunately I can't get that.
Okay, forget it.
Right.
So let's go back to just put me on the screen here. I got. So I can talk to people.
Yeah, you are on the screen.
Okay. So Gallatin, James Gallatin, the head of what were called the Associated Banks of New York, came down, demanded a meeting with the Treasury Secretary, Salmon Chase, and the committees of both houses of Congress that were dealing with this issue, and said, you can't pass a bill like this. What you need to do is follow the plan of me and my fellow bankers in New York. And that is that the government must issue bonds, and they have to be issued to the bankers, not just sold to the public. And our banks will decide what interest rate to pay to the government. And that will be the market rate. And all government funds will have to be deposited in our private banks. This was rejected with very strong words about going begging to Wall Street and to the Boston State Street. That's the equivalent of Wall Street up in Boston. And these were the bankers who did this, who proposed this, and Gallatin himself represented not just the merchant or banker class. More specifically, they represented the very top of the transatlantic imperial system. It's something like Davos or that sort of thing today. Abraham Lincoln and the Treasury Secretary and the Congress rejected these demands. The Treasury Secretary was sweating the whole time because he's really a free trader, but he was being held to do right by the country, by Lincoln and by Henry Carey, who's more than anyone the chief strategist for the administration, for the great goals of the administration. So there was a fight about this and a very informative debate, and the greenbacks passed. Now, what about this issue about the value and acceptability of unsupported money? Let's go fast forward to Alan Greenspan in the Federal Reserve. Let's see his picture. You got that? Here is Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan. He was in there from the 1990s. I don't remember all the years, but here is George W. Bush, I guess, pinning a medal on him. Go to the first printed thing for Greenspan. In 1997, Greenspan made a speech about why regulations on financiers are out of date. All regulations. What he was talking about here specifically was derivatives. The one of the most crazed kinds of banker speculation. And he said that the regulations that have been put on this in the present century are it's passé. We don't need that kind of thing anymore. And then he pointed to what happened under Lincoln. Next one. I don't know if you can't read this very well, but he says, let's see.
Do you want me to read it or?
I'll read it. The first recorded instance of federal government regulation of, he says, derivatives was the Anti-Gold Futures Act of 1864, which prohibited the trading of gold futures. In other words, he's criticizing the Lincoln government for trying to put a harness on the speculators back then. The government had been unhappy that its fiat currency issues, the infamous greenbacks, were at that time trading at a substantial discount to gold. So he's attacking the greenbacks and saying that Lincoln was being a fool to try to regulate speculators who were attacking the currency and trying to get gold to become more valuable. All right, now take that off and let's go back to think this through. Here is somebody, Alan Greenspan, chairman of the Federal Reserve, who populists love to hate. The Federal Reserve, they hate it for some of the wrong reasons, but one right reason they hate it for is that the Federal Reserve issues what's called helicopter money these days. That is, they print money or issue it electronically, and then they give it to bankers. Also under Biden, They've just passed out, a trillion, a couple trillion to the American population. That adds to the inflation, but it's pittance compared to what they gave to Wall Street. Nevertheless, this is money that directly causes inflation and degrades the economy. What's the difference between that and what the greenbacks did when we were issued at the request of the Lincoln administration? At the same time, the Lincoln administration passed a series of measures. Five great measures were passed within a two-month span the following year. And I'll tell you what those were. Creating the Agriculture Department, setting up the Transcontinental Railroad, passing a higher and higher tariff to protect manufacturers and promote them, the Land Grant College Act to provide free colleges for the citizens, and the Homestead Act to provide free farms with from the government donated the land. These are all generous acts that created a powerful industrial and agricultural miracle in the world. This idea of creating an ample currency supply, and later they passed a banking act to help issue more of such currency and to regulate the banks. But with an ample currency and then having a massive production apparatus in the economy to produce steel and railroads, and they started up the petroleum industry and the chemical industry and a massive increase in agricultural potential, so that the services of the government to the population and the population's production of the goods that you would buy with this currency was far more valuable than the nominal amount of the currency. So the currency was, beyond being fully supported, the currency was actually serving as a vehicle to cause massive progress and improvement in the economy. This system, the American system, was then copied by all the major countries that rose to power over the next century. That's how modern times came about. So you, in two different cases, in the case of the international globalists' central banking system, you have their kind of easy money, which is ruinous. And then you have another kind of what you might call easy money, not supported by gold, issued by Lincoln. And this was the opposite in its intention and its effect. These are facts that can be debated, but they cannot be debated by populists who simply deliver insults at Lincoln or at Hamilton or something. You can't get around the fact of what happened with this currency and what it was intended to do. So I'm going to leave this there, and let's go on to the next chapter. The next chapter that I'm working on is called, this one was called Lincoln versus the Money Power. The next chapter is on the reform of agriculture, the creation of the Agriculture Department, and other similar reforms that led to farmers in America being scientific and being able to integrate themselves with industry in a way that made everybody prosperous. what is, first of all, the importance of this is very little known to people today. Because it's part of that package of bills that were passed in 1862 with the tariff and the railroad and the Homestead Act. And the background of the creation of the Agriculture Department is that a farmers' movement in the United States that grew to very large proportions demanded that this Agriculture Department be set up, and also the land grant colleges be set up, or, you know, that the federal government set up colleges for the agricultural interest. This movement of American farmers was educated and led not by agrarians. If I hope everybody has heard that term. It's similar to somebody who's a romantic about agriculture, starting with Thomas Jefferson, who said we should not have manufacturing in America. Let's let the Europeans, by that really we mean England, do the manufacturing, and we will have our wonderful farmers, of which he counted himself, produce goods that will, you know, farm goods that will be sent to Europe and will trade it for manufacturing. And he said that farmers are God's chosen people. And people that get who run factories or who work in factories are corrupt. Cities are corrupt. And so that type of thinking gradually became the basis for the Confederacy, for the attempt to destroy the United States. And on the opposite side was the demand for giving farmers an alternative to exporting their crops to Europe. There were two reasons for those exports. One of them was cotton, earlier tobacco, which were sent to places like England. And they got in return the manufactured goods of England. And they were opposed for sending crops to Europe, got high prices for these commodities when there was a war quite frequently. What if the war ended? Oh God, well, too bad, you've just lost your farm because you took loans and so forth, and now you're out of business because they don't want your crops anymore. So Alexander Hamilton proposed in his report on manufactures that one of the main reasons for having manufacturing and having the government promote that with tariffs and other means is that farmers need a stable and consistent market for their goods, and it should be in our country. And that's where they'll get good prices for their goods, and it will be reliable. This was attacked by Jefferson and by the Southern, more and more by the Southern radicals, slave owner radicals. The first government administrations in our country were unsuccessful in getting this kind of program through the Congress. It was defeated largely by the opposition of the Jeffersonians and also the splitting of Hamilton's party. Well, the next picture, put up the picture of this thing here. Maybe you don't have a picture of this. I'm going to show it to you. Can people see this? American farmer. This is the masthead. Can you see this? Yeah. This is the masthead for a weekly, and I guess monthly later, but the most famous and the first agricultural periodical in the United States. It was published from 1819 and all through the century. The subheadline for this is Rural Economy, Internal Improvements, News and Prices Current. This was published by a, there you go. Put up the picture of Skinner. See if you can see this guy. John S. Skinner.
Can you see him now or no?
He's number 8 over there. It's this guy. I don't know. Never mind.
I got him. Here
you go. Okay. Yeah. There he is. He deserves to be famous. He's the one who started the 19th century farmers movement by publishing this wonderful farm magazine, a weekly newspaper or magazine, with wonderful illustrations and so forth. It was started in response to and in reaction to radical slave owner named John Taylor of Caroline, who published a book saying that the soil of the slave states and of states all up and down the East Coast, the soil was being depleted. And the reason he said this radical slave owner, the reason it was being depleted is that the government has put tariffs on everything and taxing the poor farmers. And he's an agrarian who had originally been sponsored by Jefferson. So this guy, Skinner, was also a Maryland slave owner. But he was, like George Washington, his hero. And this guy, Skinner, was part of a family that were ardent American Revolutionary patriots. His grandfather ran a shipyard in Maryland that was the naval base for the Revolution. They built the warships, and his grandfather was an agent for the whole revolutionary operation, and this shipyard was burned down by the British Marines after 5 years in operation. His family had all these revolutionary exploits. This guy himself, Skinner, was a thoroughgoing American system protectionist because he had the outlook of fighting the British in a worldwide struggle. During the War of 1812, he was working with the Henry Clay and Matthew Carey movement, and he was backing South American revolutionaries who were fighting the British in South America with American Navy. He was in with the Navy, just the same way a lot of the best American intelligence people were. This is a real American intelligence a senior person, Skinner. And he's trying to lead the South, as well as the rest of the country, into a direction that would get us out of the plantation system and industrialize the country for the interest of everybody. But in particular, he understood the international contest between the American nation, the American Republic, and the empire, the imperial system, as a system against mankind. His magazine was published for many years. In 1848, he set up a new publication called The Plow, the Loom, and the Anvil in conjunction with Henry Carey, moved his operations to Philadelphia, and he and Henry Carey put this out for several years. And it was this publication, together with people at the patent office working with Skinner, his son was employed there. It was Carey and Skinner and their immediate circle, which called for the promotion of an agriculture department in the United States. And because the Congress wouldn't do it, in 1851, they organized a conference in Washington to set up a national agricultural society, the United States Agriculture Society, which then lobbied for 10 years to get the Department of Agriculture. That's how this whole thing came about under Lincoln. So give me the picture of the two guys at Fort McHenry now. Why don't we know about this person?
I don't think I have that one.
No, really? I definitely sent it to you.
Not Dawn's Early Light, right?
Yeah, that's it.
Oh, that's it? Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so the guy up on the rail is Francis Scott Key. The guy just below him, in the top hat, is John Skinner, the guy we've been talking about. This is in 1814, when the British had burned Washington down. Skinner, who's later going to put out this Farmer's Magazine, Skinner had, when the British were on their way to Baltimore, I'm sorry, on their way to Washington, to burn Washington, he rode overnight down to Washington to warn the government about it. He was a commissioner at this time for prisoners of war, appointed by Madison, President Madison. So he and Francis Scott Key went up to the British fleet under a flag of truce, and they tried to negotiate the release of a prisoner that the British were abusing. British held them captive while they bombarded the Baltimore fortress to try to do in Baltimore what they had just done in Washington, which is burn it to the ground. But after all the firing of 1,000 bombs and rockets overnight, they saw that the flag was still flying. And so Francis Scott Key wrote a song, was always intended as a song, the Star Spangled Banner. And after they, a couple of mornings later, when he was done with it, Skinner brought it to the newspapers and it was published and later became the national anthem of the United States. How come we don't know so much about Skinner? Well, one problem is Francis Scott Key, both of these guys were slave owners. As I said, Skinner was trying to move the country in an opposite direction to that. And he had a sense of the nation as an instrument for progress. Francis Scott Key at this point was a patriot, but he was also in an extended network of scoundrels His brother-in-law was Roger Taney, who was known for taking the deposits out of the Bank of the United States for Andrew Jackson, and then for issuing the famous Dred Scott decision. So this guy, Roger Taney, is Francis Scott Key's brother-in-law, close to Key. He wrote something years after this event that took Skinner out of the story. Yeah, Skinner was on the boat with Francis Scott Key, said Taney, but he didn't bring this thing to the newspapers. That was somebody else. So he tried to change the story to diminish the role of this guy. So why am I bringing all this up? You can't remember any of this and so forth, but you're starting to get the idea that, my God, these are sort of central events in American history, right? And so here is a question of slavery. We hear a lot about that today, right? It's like one of these hot button issues historically. Today we have the issue of immigration. It's a very similar kind of thing. We have a lot of other issues like these. And there would be an attack on the United States without any reference to what fight was happening with immense results on the good side. No sense of the background of this whole conflict and what it led to. Lincoln was part of the movement started by Skinner and Carey and Henry Clay. That included Lincoln's passionate insistence to the farmers that they had to improve their farming. Now, the big issue there was the depletion of soil. People were leaving the East Coast. Slave owners were going out west and demanding the right to take their slaves with them. Why were they leaving the East Coast and going west? Because they had ruined the soil in Virginia and Maryland and other states. According to Henry Carey, and according to Skinner, and according to the famous German scientist Justus Liebig, the reason for this was, for the soil depletion, was that American farmers sent their products overseas. And so all of the nutrients in the soil that went into the products were never recycled back into the soil. If you have a family farm and just consume what you produce, you don't sell it to the outside world at all. Of course, you have animal manure and you use the decayed vegetation and so forth, no problem. If you're selling a surplus and you're selling it overseas, nothing is recycled. They were just starting to use artificial fertilizer, and Liebig and all these people were promoting the idea of using mineral fertilizer, which doesn't come from a farm, but which is going to add to the manure and other things and in ways that were coming to be understood from chemistry. But according to Henry Carey's book, The Past, the Present, and the Future, was published in 1848. His second book was called, it dealt with this issue of the soil depletion. That was a central issue. He proposed that farmers should get a market for their goods nearby the farms. You should have cities and towns with industry near the farms. Then you could recycle. The farms sell their products, and the waste product comes back to the farm to use. I was kind of curious about that. What did he really mean by that? Human defecation is dangerous to use in a farm. And I think they did do that in places in ancient times and in Asia later. I guess they know how to do it without spreading disease, but that's not something that happened in the USA. But one form of that recycling was a huge accumulation of horse dung that was brought back to farms as manure. And if the city is close to the farms, it's very cheap. You're not going to get that from England on a ship. They're not going to send a ship full of horse crap. So exports have to be replaced. And there's other kinds of waste product from industry and other things from a town. So that's reasonable. And plus you get a better market nearby. And all the economics are better if industry is interspersed with farming. When we went away from that in the 1920s under corporate control of the country and bankers' control, we destroyed the land in Kansas and other places. We had the Dust Bowl. So this whole concept of the need to replenish the earth and the value in the soil coming entirely from man's work, not just what's there naturally. That's, in a sense, it's irrelevant. This undercuts the Malthusian environmentalists completely, because their whole idea is that the soil has this natural value, and that determines, that's like a magic treasure from nature. And it doesn't work that way. I had a very good conversation yesterday with Marcia Baker, who is the agricultural editor for EIR. Has done great work in the past with her husband, Bob Baker. And we were talking about this question of soil depletion and these characters like Skinner, who started the farmers movement. By the way, Skinner also published Carey's book, The Harmony of Interests, in 1851. So Marcia pointed out that you don't need soil at all. As we know, right, you have hydroponics, but if you go to Holland, you see that the Netherlands is this, I think she said it was the second largest exporter of agricultural products. A little country like that. Why is that? Because they have this wonderful soil-less agriculture. How come it's there? Well, it's because of finance, because the Anglo-Dutch imperialists, and specifically the kind of rotten finance leaders that you have in Holland, control the patents and the technology, so-called intellectual property, for this kind of technology. And they won't let any other place have it. But this shows you what can be accomplished to produce without being tied down by the stupid notion that man's future is all a question of dirt. Dirt doesn't govern our future and our destiny. That's ridiculous. Man's mind and compassion working together to decide our future. So that's enough for this, for the present.
Thank you, Anton. And yeah, on the note, that final ringing note that you left us with, I'd recently watched a documentary on aeroponics, which I think is what you're alluding to. And I didn't realize that the Netherlands was so advanced in this. But this came, a lot of people say, well, what's the point of having a space program when we have so many problems on the Earth? And in this documentary, they clearly got across that this technology of developing aeroponics, the free-hanging roots that have intermittent sprays of vitamin-rich water with special UV lights that are fully grown inside, are a product of NASA, in NASA trying to come up with different ideas in the 90s of how do you sustain life outside of the sphere of the atmosphere of the Earth. But it also uses 80% less water than typical agricultural practices. It uses, I mean, far less energy and everything else. So, I mean, and you could produce a lot more with no fertilizers, nothing else even, or pesticides. And they grow richer, more vitamin rich, quicker. And there's all of these new techniques of producing abundance, which people aren't thinking of, which wouldn't happen had you not had a space program. This simply would not, the resources wouldn't have been provided. And the outside the box thinking would not have been made available had that not occurred. So to always have this receptivity or the reciprocal, that's a terrible way I pronounce that.
Reciprocal,
thank you. Relationship between industry, science, and agriculture, the way Henry C. Carey got across, is wonderful. And the figures that you've introduced, I didn't even hear of several of them. And I'm really grateful for knowing that they now exist, that such that they could be pursued. I know we had a couple of questions. Peter just introduced a question early on. So Peter, go for it.
Thanks, Matthew. Good to see you again, Anton.
Hi.
I had a question for you, whether the 1944 GI Bill of Rights was more like the five bills that passed in 1862 versus 21st century helicopter money. I can see elements of both within the GI Bill. I could see that the real estate, you know, industry really benefited from it in substantial way. Yet there was also the component that improved education, and there were small business loans that created the abundance where there wasn't before. So I'm wondering what you think.
Yeah, I think that's a wonderful entry point to look at what Lincoln was doing and also FDR. Both Lincoln and FDR were passionate about the veterans, but they were, what were they looking forward to? A world without war. They were organizing our economy to a full-scale mobilization. The mobilization for World War II was not simply to produce the armaments, although that was the central point, but it was gearing up a something of industry and tools that was beyond anything that had been done before. And the same thing happened with Lincoln and for a few years after Lincoln. That would have been the basis for a peaceful world. In that world, what better segment of the population to play the role of a mature but youthful, in the case of people who were from had just been in the war, veteran who had the idea, both the American veterans, if that is from both the Civil War and from the World War II, had this concept that they can accomplish anything. The whole country had that, but veterans would have been in the middle of this if they grasped what this was all about. It was a widespread feeling of that the world of the future was going to be based on something like the four freedoms that Franklin Roosevelt was promoting. So the veterans bill the education bill was part of that vision of the future. It was supposed to be based on carrying forward the alliance that fought Hitler and Japan. That would include Russia, which was then communist. It would include China, which was not then communist, but was divided. It would include Britain, which was an empire, which we didn't approve of, but which was also a nation that ought to participate as a nation after we throttled down the British Empire. We wanted to be friends and cooperate with every major country to get things done. And who better to get things done than veterans? So this is a very calculated thing for their benefit, right? The benefit, there's a huge number of veterans in World War II. I mean, how many? 16 million members of the armed forces, something like that. So it's very much like that. It has to do with the same kind of package of measures that Lincoln passed. Like you said, if you see it in that light, it's not just a giveaway. When we were at our most generous, in a generous, the way a parent is generous, you want to give your child everything. That's not the same thing as loading him up with candy. That's not the same thing as letting them destroy themselves somehow. All right, you're a parent. You're trying to provide the avenues and the supplies and the contacts and whatever else for the child to make something of themselves. And this is a whole generalize. We're in the future. He knew what he was very much aware, like Lincoln was, of the devil in the enemy camp, which was these finance. I want to bring up one thing that is from this era that you mentioned, and that is PBS has a series right now about the U.S. and the Holocaust, and it's about how the United States did not allow the entry of Jews who were fleeing from Hitler to take refuge in the United States. They were turned away. And at first, when I heard that this was being, this kind of Ken Burns documentary was being done, I thought, well, maybe the reason they're doing this is to attack FDR. But it's much more specific than this. It's an attack on Donald Trump and the Republicans, because it says that nativists in the United States, that is anti-immigrant people, were the ones who were behind keeping the Jews out and making them go back to Germany and die in the Holocaust. And obviously, the first thing you would say is, well, here, you're being very selective about the way you're covering the Holocaust. As I've discussed with you and a lot of other people, my father did something, and others working with him, to fight the Wall Street and London connection to Hitler and the promotion of Hitler. How did he ever get into power? How did they keep his regime going? How'd they keep working with him into the war and after the war to revive this, to revive the attack on Russia after the war, to divide the world? The selective use of history in order to attack a political opponent is not just wrong, it's sad. Because people deep inside, they have to be ashamed about what they're doing. If you look at these migrants today, people coming in from South America and Mexico, Central America. Democrats care more about them than Republicans do, but they don't care enough to do anything about their problem. In other words, they say just, you know, we love them. And then they're dying. They're dying in Central America. They're dying here. There's massive poverty among these migrants and crime to them and by them and God knows what. It's no good to just attack them and say they're criminals. But there's no sense, like Roosevelt and Lincoln had, of trying to improve the conditions of the people, these people or anybody else. Where, you know, it's like the voting. Democrats are for letting people vote. Republicans want to restrict that. It's ironic that the people they want, the people who are poor or without resources or black, have nothing, no reason to vote for the Democrats except that they're promoting their right to vote. Otherwise, they're participating in their destruction. Where is the idea, like in this veterans bill and like the gear up of industry, where's the idea of promoting a peaceful and prosperous world? It's just not there at all. It's shameful.
Mm-hmm. Well said. We got the next question from Stephen Doyle.
Thanks, Anton. I really enjoyed your talk. I guess I have more of a thought or a comment, and maybe I ask you to respond to it. Your lecture today, to me, speaks to why history is so beautiful and why it's so important, and your exercise of discerning the actual truth of matters versus what we've been taught to believe or led to believe is so important. And the two basic subjects you brought up today in terms of Lincoln and the evil money doers and also agricultural reform, to me seems highly relevant, because I see almost similar things going on today, you know, with Russia and Sergei Glazyev and trying to reform the global monetary system, financial system. And also we see in the West the attempts to undermine agriculture, banning fertilizer, all these food factories that seem to be mysteriously burning, and it's almost like it's deja vu all over again. So I just wanted to say thank you, but you know, for beyond what you taught me, the meta lesson, if you will, on the true value of history and how you have to search for it and use it and apply it in today. I mean, that's the whole value of it, understanding where you've come from so you know where you are and how to course correct into the future, if you will. And I was just wondering if you had thoughts about that, perhaps.
Well, I'm always anxious and sometimes get a little bit sad about my own ability to do what I have to do. It's very difficult for me, aside from the time and resources, it's difficult for me to get the, you know, to find these things. And even more difficult to try to put together what they mean and make sure that what I'm thinking they mean is true. And I can only do a little bit at a time. And so I think back on people like Lincoln and people like Franklin Roosevelt and people like Hamilton, and you think of them as being flawed. How do I know they were flawed? Well, I know certain things about them, but also I know my own flaws and where I shy away from the kinds of things that are most difficult and traumatic emotionally. And also that might get me into the kinds of fights that I don't want to be in. So I can see in my own work what must have really was problematical for them. Think about Franklin Roosevelt and the question of Thomas Jefferson. Franklin Roosevelt was the one who built the Jefferson Memorial in Washington. It's a beautiful building. And Jefferson had certain qualities that were good. A lot of what he did was ambiguous, like the, what do you call it, the purchase, the Louisiana Purchase. No plan for developing it, but also, what are you going to do out there? But why would Franklin Roosevelt, who's the very model of strong central government acting for the benefit of the population, in my view, why would he promote somebody like Jefferson, who was opposed to that concept of government and aborted the first industrialization attempt at the time of the founding? Part of it is that Roosevelt had a Southern Congress component that was powerful. His own party, a large part of it, were Southern, not only Southern racists, but a power structure that went from the South to Wall Street, to the universities, to England. It's really the same thing. It never was overturned. He knew he had to get around that. And so if he attacked Jefferson, he's unleashing something. And so he's gonna limit what he's gonna be able to do. Same thing with John Kennedy. He was slow to get in with Martin Luther King and civil rights. And he tried to outflank the problem. Lincoln had exactly the same problem. Lincoln never came out like Henry Clay or Carey and said, I'm on the side of Hamilton against Jefferson. He even invoked Jackson, Andrew Jackson, when Jackson or Jefferson had done something for protectionism. And Lincoln is slow about slavery. But they don't feel themselves capable of going before the public and saying, I'm going to talk to you now about something that deeply troubles this country, and we need to deal with this. Come hell or high water, we're going to deal with this. Here's what happened at the founding. Take up the question of American Indians. Lincoln wasn't in a position to do that, but FDR was, and they tried to get something going to change the treatment of the Indians then. But they could have dealt with this. It would take a very strong leader to take this on, because you have to do what I'm trying to do with these tricky questions of money. You have to say, look, there's something really wrong here, but there was a fight going on, and there were two intentions. One was to conquer the West, and one was to develop the West. If you develop the West, you can include the Indians in it. Their way of life is gone as soon as you build the Transcontinental Railroad. But if you fully develop the West the way Lincoln wanted to, then you can offer something to them. You got nothing if there's nobody going to live out there, if it stays a desert, if there's only, a few million populists living in the Mountain West and so forth. If you don't have industry and 150, 200 million people who are settling their modern scientific agriculture and hooking up the whole West with Asia and the rest of the world, a whole center of new civilization wasn't done. It was blocked by people, culminating with Teddy Roosevelt. But the good people that I'm going to be writing about in this book in this volume, one had a different idea about the West, civilization. And it goes back to this question of agriculture. Which model of agriculture? A farm that concentrates and is equipped to have scientific practices, that fully develops the potential of the soil, and that has nearby industry, and you have an interchange there, and they develop together. That is the background for the setting for civilization. That's the opposite of gunslingers and saloons and prostitutes and cattle barons and mining barons. It's a whole different idea. Civilization is gradual and gentle, but it has a passionate idea about human destiny and all kinds of new things. I think the last exemplification of this way of thinking was the Wright brothers. They were a product, the sort of the last influence of Abraham Lincoln. They've came up with all of their ideas themselves. They used the government, information from Da Vinci to all the other things that were from government sources. And they had this fantastic optimism. And their idea of flying was very gentle, copying the curling of the wingtips of the birds, like Da Vinci studied. But the idea, if you're going to control how you use nature and control what nature does, it's not conquering nature. It's understanding the harmonies, living in harmony with nature, absolutely. Like the best American Indian idea. But it's aided by the kind of penetrating analysis of the unseen in matter and energy, so that you see the harmonies of nature that are all through the universe and which are available with infinite potential for us if we can channel these harmonies and these energies into using them for man. Not in a fake way by saying, well, somebody has an invention. I know they have an invention that will solve everything. And they attribute that to some guy that we don't know about, or somebody we know about and, you know, he was killed or something. Bunk. What we're talking about is the idea of agro-industrial development that is shared between the nations. That is the compassionate and genius idea that America gave to the world. And it was only a very small minority of its leaders that did that, that were leading that. The population always loved it when they could be part of something like that. That's how we accomplish things. Otherwise, the leaders were stupid and the people followed suit. So that history is often very sad because it's so hard to put together the story of this fight and the beautiful things that have been accomplished. I wish that our country had a truth commission, you know, that would support history research and writing, and would investigate the most important things and really take on the hard subjects that where the country has done something really wrong, and look for what was the direction for the good in those situations. Mm-hmm. We need that now because we're murdering people all over the world in the wars, including in Ukraine. I guess Nancy Pelosi just took off for Armenia to urge one side in the new war over there. The more wars, the better. It's Tuesday. There must be a war in some new country or whatever day it is. I don't know.
I got a quick question for you. Do we have you? I've got about five questions still waiting in queue. Do we have you until about 4 o'clock or so?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, good. Yeah, no, before the next question, I think it's just so important that you differentiate the source of the criticism that there's this supposed animosity between technology and science and nature and nature's supposed harmonies, which are operating on a completely separate set of principles than the developments that we see with human economic growth when it is driven by technological and industrial progress. And so this is obviously we could see where Monsanto and we could see where globalization perverted the utilization of industrial growth and turned it into a perversion of what it actually should have and was at its source. But the idea of science being returned to its founding principles, which is that science and its fruits, technology, they flow with nature. They're not in opposition to nature. It's the same principles operating in both realms. And that nature itself is imbued with a force of creative progress, even without the factor of human beings. We still see the strong evidence in evolutionary time of creative change, new biological innovations coming online that didn't exist previously, like photosynthesis, constantly leaping beyond the limits to growth. So this idea that there's this, like, that nature is natural when it is not changing and in like mathematical equilibrium and homeostasis is a complete fallacy, which previous generations to our own did not really believe in. This is a really new messed up belief, which has contaminated a lot of people's ability to think about how do you really develop Africa? What's the natural state of human beings? And instead we're going along with this absurd idea of population reduction and adapting to scarcity, which is the most unnatural thing ever. So I love how you're sensitive to that. And that's how you've guided your investigation into the rise of a natural development policy from the revolution and even before that throughout the 19th century into the 20th and beyond. It's really good. Not every, able to catch that.
Every attack against the United States, it's based on something that has happened in history. It isn't just a general name calling. Every attack has, you know, locates something that was done wrong. Mm-hmm. And so any serious investigation has to take these things up in a serious way. Right now, there's no discussion of serious principles in politics that's not overridden by fear and rage on almost any topic. But if you're going to, and this is for people that are anti-establishment, if you're going to defend, pro-human elements in history, you have to really be willing to take up the really hard questions that seem to embarrass your side. You have to take them up. And this is where I got seriously discombobulated by the people that got themselves fixed on Donald Trump, because they weren't lifting themselves above this problem. I mean, Trump, more than any of these other people, never was able to explain to the public anything deep about the history that he was referring to all the time. The trade policy and all these other things, nationalism. But you have to be able to take on really deep shames and crimes of mankind and of our country, and still be able to point people to what we were doing and what the best people were trying to do to redeem fallen mankind and to take care of their grandchildren.
Amen. Sam, I know you've been waiting. Are you still there? Sam LaBriere. Let me see if he's still there. There he is. Sam, you're on mute, just so you know. And your computer might be frozen. Ooh, tough connection, Sam. All right. I'm going to call on somebody else, Sam. Now? Oh, there you are. There you are.
Can you see me now, Matt?
Yeah, it's rough, but we can hear you.
Can you see me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me know if it drops out or anything.
I don't
see. I just want to say thanks to Anton for being here. Thank you so much for being here. It was a great talk. It was very educational. There's a lot of new links that you were exposing in the Lincoln era. And I just wanted to ask you about a couple of remarkable articles from way back in the day that I found in researching Jeffrey Epstein and the whole Epstein story. And I was looking into Les Wexner, who was Epstein's funder, and came to find that EIR and Jeffrey Steinberg and Scott Thompson published in 2001 a series of articles about the mega group and the Bronfmans and Les Wexner
Omega
involved in this. It was right at the mega group. And they were
okay.
The article in 2001 was talking about sexual blackmail on President Clinton by this mega group of Les Wexner. And I found it really remarkable because, you know, this is the kind of stuff that back then would get the LaRouche movement painted as conspiracy theorists, right? That turned out to be so bang on. And even to the point of ignoring Epstein entirely and going beyond Epstein and looking at his actual controllers and exposing them. It was really remarkable. And it started me down this rabbit hole of discovering all these connections between the Epstein networks and the typically the Anglo-American networks, like Epstein was part of the CFR and the Trilateral Commission. Felix Rohatyn, who gets mentioned a lot, was the lawyer for Leslie Wexner. The guy who introduced Jeffrey Epstein to Hoffenberg in that pyramid scheme that collapsed was Sir Douglas Leith, who's a British intelligence operative. So just things like that got me down a rabbit hole into looking at, you know, the sexual blackmail operations of Epstein, who was, you know, he was like a Mossad agent, but he also had these ties everywhere. And then I came across an article from you on Stephen Wolf. Sorry, I had it open on my computer. And it was on during the Civil War, Simon Wolf's role in the assassination of Abraham Lincoln that you wrote in 1993. And you're talking about B'nai B'rith, the founding of B'nai B'rith in the 1840s and 50s as a project of Scottish Rite of Freemasonry, and how the Jews who started the B'nai B'rith were like in contrary to the vast majority of Jews in the United States who were pro-union and were anti-slavery, and they claimed, right, to represent the views of Jewish people, but really they represented the views of B'nai B'rith, which was contrary to the Jewish community. And this is something that I'm trying to wrestle with, and I wonder if you have anything that you could say about either that idea of like Zionism and B'nai B'rith ADL being, I believe you called them apostate Jews in this article, and just the notion that they go against you know, the best of what Judaism represents. And also, if you can just help elucidate at all the relationship between what we call the Anglo-American networks and the Zionist Israel, how does Israel fit into that picture, this of geopolitical analysis?
First of all, let me ask you, you started off with Epstein and sexual blackmail against Clinton, and you went through certain different historical things and you got to Jews and Zionism. Is that the thread that connects the whole thing that you were saying?
Well, Epstein is, it's known that Epstein and Les Wexner and Mega Group were an operation of Mossad. But then it's not just Mossad, right? They're working with MI6, they're working with CIA. And so I'm just trying to understand better how like Zionism and Israel fits in, like to imperialism, what we talk about as Anglo-American, Anglo-Dutch imperialism, however we reference it. You know, are they like a junior partner to the British Empire? Have they taken over? Did they blackmail all the British and now they're controlling the British? I really don't know.
Well, I don't recall speaking with you about these kind of subjects, but I would say that when you're wrestling with these topics, you're likely to end up wrestling yourself. Sort of like, I don't know, you know, going around in a circle. There's nothing to grip. I don't know what might have started the thing, the discussion or the inquiry, but it's at the you're starting it in the at the wrong level.
What started it was just finding these two articles on Mega.
No, I know that, but those are, you're also selecting out these articles. So
I just found them really remarkable research that, you know.
I think, you know, that I agree that these topics are of they're important, and there's certainly the question of Israel today is an important question, and the relationship of the U.S. to that and to imperialism and so forth is very important. If you would be patient enough here, I'd like to address the way people think about these things. And that, to me, gets to the truth about these things. You can't really separate those two things. So in there's a guy that I mentioned when I was talking about agriculture, this guy, John Taylor of Caroline. And in his essays that he published, it came out in a book during the War of 1812, and Skinner attacked this, or, you know, went against this way of thinking. It's agrarian, but in his book, this is sort of the ultimate populist presentation. And he said that we, mechanics and agriculturalists, have always been slaves. Kind of ironic because he's a slave owner and represents the most elite slave owners. But he's appealing to rural prejudice. And he says that we've been slaves to the bankers, not even bankers, but to capitalists, to use that word again and again. And what we want is to be left alone. He is attacking government and national purpose. It cannot exist. The only purpose of a government is to enrich and make more powerful those who are already powerful. And he identifies them as capitalists. And he also speaks of the alien race of stock jobbers. And I suppose that in the mind of somebody reading that, that might be interpreted as being Jews. I'm not sure. As to what Jews did what thing and how the Jewish community itself was divided, or sins and crimes committed by Jews, I don't think that's what you want to get involved in right now. But the populist in America and in Russia, let's just take those two countries because they sort of go together, good and bad, those two countries. The populists are quite similar. They have a certain kind of fatal mental problem. And the mental problem is that they cannot see themselves as being the government. The government itself, the idea of government, is wrong in their view. And by having that view, they can't know anything about the needs and the suffering of other human beings, because you need power, the power of society, to do good and to solve problems and to keep the oligarchs and the empires from destroying everybody. So the populist is instructed by partial stories, partial truths. Oh, everything that you said and everything that I might have brought up in some article may have been, if that article is taken by itself, true. And yet, if that article or that subject, that topic, is taken by itself, it's a monstrous folly and not true at all. Because you're not confronting the central problem, which is, what should we do? How should mankind save itself? How should we solve the problems? And this is what we've always, ever since the ancient civilizations began, how are we going to govern so that we solve problems, real problems, not just government problems, but the problems confronting mankind? How do we eat? How do we have better culture? How do we educate? How do we have a good standard of living? How do we have productive work? How do we prevent war, just constantly an affliction on people? How do we prevent the hatred and revenge cycles in history? Of course, Zionism and various terrorist groups created among the Arabs by both sides, in my view, created by these intelligence services, imperial services. But how do we solve man's problems? The government does that. And if you are a wise person, you are aiming at governing. You know, in the classical stories, people save their souls, even at the last time of their life, by trying to aim at good government and doing something that will cause good government, that will solve problems, that redeems you. So you don't go to hell for all of your past sins. But populism is a way of wrestling with yourself on topics of combating evil without any notion of how government has been and should be solving the world's problems. So it's an endless cycle. It's like a tornado of combating evil and in my view, doing evil. Populists and mobs are get tangled up together. So that's really my my answer to it. You know, you can find, I was disappointed in Bill Clinton, you know, his administration, and you can say that he was blackmailed, and it's probably true. Probably that was going on with, what's his name, with Kennedy as well. But Kennedy went in one direction and Clinton went in another direction, and he and his wife ended up with well over $100 million. And they didn't get it by working on a farm. There's no bottom to that wrestling match. There's no fundamental truth that you get to. And there's no.
I hear you, Anton. I want to thank you for that answer because it was fantastic. And I would just say that my only concern is, how do you govern for the benefit of people with these like blackmail operations going on amongst the leaders of society? And that's why I found it so concerning. I'm going to let you go now because a bunch of other people want to ask questions, but thank you so much.
It's good to, I mean, that's one of the things that, and I know we're running out of time, so I'm not going to even throw my thought out there. I know we have to get to three more questions of people who've been waiting for a while, so I'm going to hold back. Vince, are you still there? There you are. Vince, go for it.
Yeah, thanks, Anton, for your time. And my question has to do with, what effect did Lincoln's anti-gold futures Act of 1864 have on the money power, and did it actually if you have the time to talk a little bit about how they then devalued the greenback?
Okay, well, according to Greenspan, who's trying to tell you his version of history, the Congress passed a law that was trying to basically shut down the gold room. Lincoln hated these guys who were trying to buy and bid up the price of gold and sell and bid down the price of the U.S. securities and the greenbacks. As Greenspan explains it, this was entirely unsuccessful on the part of the administration. They had to back off. They couldn't control these guys. This may be true about the gold room or gold speculation. And the fact is that the market price of greenbacks did fall during the war, but it never collapsed. Never collapsed like the continental dollar did during the revolution. It might have gone down to half par value, but it rose and fell according to whether the public had confidence in the government. Often as a result of, you know, winning battles, or whether people thought the Emancipation Proclamation would be a successful measure against the Confederate threat. But these greenbacks, in fact, stayed in circulation through the war and afterwards, along with national banknotes and certain other forms of currency. The greenbacks were the real center of it. They were about 40% of the currency at the time, at the end of the war, the largest single component of it. But they, as I had mentioned, they provided the lubrication, the circulation for facilitating every aspect of the economy. And it was an increasingly productive economy. At the end of the war, the measures that had been passed by Lincoln were able to take full effect. In particular, right after the war was over, I think it was in June of 1865, the first substantial United States steel mill was set up by the leaders of the Pennsylvania Railroad. It was called the Pennsylvania Steel Company. And they used the latest technology, which was Bessemer, and also a guy named Kelly, an American inventor. And they, leader of the Pennsylvania Railroad, Tom Scott, also had this protege, Carnegie, who later developed the huge steel mill there in Pittsburgh. But all kinds of new ventures, often done by patriots and people excited about the role they would play and proud of being able to contribute something to make their name on the future of the country and mankind. And they were operating in many different countries for the benefit of those other countries as well as ours. All of this was productive in a way beyond just producing goods more than the currency. It was a way of increasing the ability of the future to produce. Somebody's not muted right now.
I got that. It's fixed.
Can I keep going?
Yes.
So at this point, right after the war, the act that we were talking about to try to control the gold speculators was in 64. In a year later, there was a huge fight. It had been going on the whole time, but it was led by Henry Carey, and he was trying to get the leaders of the Republican Party to stay with their alliance with working people and farmers. And by keeping the greenbacks in circulation, because this was the people's money, and this was fueling the tremendous increase in the power of the economy to do good. There was, over the course of the rest of the 19th century, a terrible depression in prices. Contrary to inflation, there was too much deflation, which meant that farm prices were going down. They were subject to monopolies and to all kinds of other problems. But the question of the speculation, that involves individual greed and markets, but it doesn't get to this basic contest between the leadership on both sides of this issue. The contest is, what is the intention for the future of the economy? Is it to have the United States and other countries become 10 times more powerful? Or is it to keep mankind divided and in weak countries so that they can be ruled and taken advantage of by an imperial clique? Those are the two intentions. A free market in securities, buying and selling bonds and stocks, and various forms of things that we think of as speculation, is not really the problem. You've always had markets of different kinds, markets in produce and so forth. You simply have to have the government and the nation guiding the use of the activities of a market, so that it's acting for the benefit of advancing the economy. You know, you're not substituting government ownership. You're not banning people's right to invest in what they want to invest in. You're just guiding the markets and the investment flow into productive channels. So the greenbacks, the fight over the greenbacks eventually led to a party, the Greenback Party, and later the Greenback hyphen Labor Party, the Greenback Labor Party. Carey was involved in that. Also, Terence Powderly, the labor leader, the Knights of Labor, and others. And this was continuing the same fight, although it wasn't about tariffs, it was about money. But the issue there, again, was the two directions for the economy. This is very difficult. By the way, the person who first brought all this up in the best way, in a heroic way, was Alan Salisbury, who wrote his book, The Civil War and the American System, published by the LaRouche organization. Alan wrote this in 1978, and he is a black, I think from Baltimore, young man. He only lived to 42, but he did a heroic thing responding to the publication of Roots. I don't know if people are familiar with that. It purports to give the African background to the American crime of slavery, and it's something from the post 60s attack on the American Republic, and it gets into things which are true, the crime of slavery, but which, like the woke baloney today, is not intended to solve anything. It's intended to govern the way people think and keep them from attacking the world's problems from the standpoint of doing something about them. Alan, as a black person and as a political leader, revived the history of Henry Carey, and particularly centered his thing on the greenbacks and the fight over them, and the fight with London and with these bankers, including James Gallatin. He wasn't in a position to get into Gallatin's background quite to the extent that I've been able to do. I've got the internet, and I can't go out much from my house anyway, so that helps me in a certain way. But this what I'm bringing this up because this is a very subtle issue. Money is not a simple question. It's not just about money, and it's not just about money being good or bad. It's about the intention of the use of money and other things for advancing human powers. So, yeah, it is a very subtle question, and you can't understand these issues of speculation without starting from the idea of progress, what that's about, where it comes from. What is it economically? What does it reflect about human beings and their nature? What parts of science are wrong and cockeyed, deeply flawed and wrong? And what avenues of improvement of science have we had in the past that gained us the heights with the greatest science? Right now, there's starting to be a debate about the so-called Big Bang Theory. Which you've gone into there, but anyway, that's way off the topic. But speculation is not a subject in itself.
Mm-hmm. Good. Thanks, Anton.
Yeah, just so you know, Anton, Vincent recently founded an organization called the Alternative Education Alliance, and he and his collaborator, Brandy, have been working with Cynthia and myself to put together a series of videos on peace, progress, and prosperity, showcasing this better forgotten spirit of progress. So I'll send you a couple of videos, Anton. I think you'll enjoy them a lot.
That sounds like Eisenhower's slogan.
Oh, yeah, right. I didn't even think of that. we got two more questions. So I know we're past four. Is that okay? Can we squeeze out two?
Yeah, for a little while. Go ahead. Right.
So John, I'm on, and then we have Jonathan. So John first, then Jonathan.
I don't think I had a question. I think it was more of a
IBM question, wasn't it? Didn't you ask something about?
Oh yeah. Well, I watched a documentary not too long ago. I think it was 2 hours long. It was a while back. It was about IBM working with the Nazis to create the punch card technology and various other technologies to start industrializing the extermination of the Jews. And I think we were talking earlier about the relation to Wall Street during the World War II and how they stopped Jews from escaping to America. And that was what kind of sparked the thought of what if you knew any relation IBM had to the Wall Street at the time. They probably did, but I'm not really clued in on that. Peter gave me some good suggestions for books as well. Just throw that out there.
Well, I am not an expert on IBM. I actually worked for them at some point doing computer programming before this, the internet. But anyway, IBM definitely had something to do with backing the Nazis. There were industrialists like the guy that ran IBM. What was his name? Shoot,
Watson.
Watson, that's right. Yeah, I think that's right. It's the name of their computer or their robot or whatever. But I wouldn't want to say that the technology of the punch cards or computers is somehow implicated in promoting Nazism. That doesn't even make sense. It's the social, political, family, banking network through the private affairs of families in Europe and governments and other institutions like the Bank of England and stuff in Geneva around the League of Nations, all kinds of things that were working together with people like the Dulles brothers, who were lawyers for all these big corporations and banks in New York, and for Hitler. So there was a complex of no goodniks in New York and London, who were they weren't just in bed with Hitler. They had an idea of a world that needed to be crushed. This civilized humanity was too big for its britches. That's the point of view. And so they promoted from way before official fascism started, they promoted many different avenues into fascism and then got fascism going in Europe and tried to get it started here. They got it going in France and other places. It didn't completely take over the government, but it was big. And this was a united effort by big shot families and corporations and banks in this high society. It's not all high society, but I think that when people identify a corporation like IBM with this, or some oil company, some particular company, it's really a mistake, because it misses what's actually being done and who's doing it. You have a project to shift the United States away from the Lincoln era. The end of the Lincoln era was the presidency of Teddy Roosevelt, the murder of McKinley that brought him in. In many, many ways, the Lincoln era was terminated then. And he went into, President Teddy Roosevelt went into a partnership with the Prince Edward, Prince of Wales, who became King Edward VII. I guess it was in 1902, I think it was. And the president, Teddy Roosevelt, and Edward, reorganized the intelligence operations of both countries, England and USA, and prepared the strategic landscape for a world that was to be transformed for war. World War One. I mean, the way I'm going to put this in my book is that together, Teddy Roosevelt and this guy prepared the way for Verdun, which is the slaughter in World War One, for Barbarossa, the attack on Russia by the Nazis, and for Pearl Harbor. They turned these different countries against the United States and against civilized humanity. And this is not, it's not the USA or the nation of Britain that's doing this. It's this complex of these families and with these intentions who have power. Who's running the policy today? Who's running this fascist policy? We've murdered so many millions in Afghanistan and in Iraq and in Syria, caused so many millions of refugees. Americans say nothing about it, by and large. They may have protested Iraq or something, but these things are going on without Americans saying much at all. And so if you look back at IBM and point the finger, I mean, I'm embarrassed by that kind of thing to say that. Don't tell me about some company like that. What about today? What about this tradition in America that leads to the present globalism, the present system of war? That's a tradition on the enemy side against our greatest leaders. Franklin Roosevelt went against the worst policies of his cousin Teddy Roosevelt, even though he married Teddy Roosevelt's niece, Eleanor. He changed his mind. So it kind of rankles me to think about the way this is used, this kind of finger pointing. It's true that there were bad men that did specific bad acts to bring about mass murder, like the Holocaust. But the problem is, if you have a system and an intention to crush the world, that's going to be the result. And some people are going to get really bad thoughts in their head, like Hitler did. And you have the same thing today. We're pumping weapons all over the world. Anyway, I don't want to get too much farther into that. I'm going to try to get the background of this evil, but only in what I write in the next couple of volumes. But I'm concentrating on what we did that elevated mankind and what we need to resume. That's you can't understand any of this evil without starting with that.
That's a great answer. Thank you so much.
That's also true about the victims, about the Jews, and about the other people. You have to start with what are the values, not just in the religion itself, but what were the accomplishments that maybe Israel disregards in the background of Jews operating in Europe to advance civilization or the whatever. The we're bombarded with these stories of evil and people furiously trying to pick out their best choice for who's really evil and other people who are not guilty and so forth. It's wrestling with the devil and you lose.
What I really like about your approach to history, and I was flipping through the other day your Treason in America book that you published way back when, I think in 84, is that you're generally encouraging people to look for the drama in history. Mm. And when you look at classical drama, you're looking for the stories, you know, like, how do you remember so many names and dates? How do you remember all of these facts? And I think the thing about you is that you're always looking for the story that is shaped by individuals who are rarely black or white. I don't think they're ever black or white. Individuals, just as nations or as corporations or whatever, any institution that wields power to do things, whether it's, again, on any level, right? Any agency that has a power to do things is rarely black or white. It's usually an admixture. Jefferson being one example, you know, Kennedy had problems. Everybody, you know, who doesn't have problems? Who doesn't have things that they could be better at? Or they have, that are, you know, but at the same time, you have personalities who either give into their tragic identities and become and completely destroy the potential for good that they could have done. Other people overcome their fears, their corruption, and they become better people. And they break from their tragic impulses and become great and vital and important personalities. And the same thing for when these individuals take control or get influence within institutions, private or public, those institutions are imbued by that virtue and that overcoming of tragedy and can do good things. When you have a proper leadership, a proper set of ideas, putting the system into motion, and you know, you could build things with the military just as much as you could destroy things. You could build things with you know, a corporation as much as you could destroy things. And it really all depends. I think what you're trying to get at is that people, we tend to jump the gun sometimes in wanting to put a black and white label onto something as purely good or purely evil to find a causal explanation for something.
Let me leave you with this, okay?
Wait, but then we go out one more question. Go ahead. I've been waiting for so long.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. If you want to jump in and say something based on what I just said, go for it. If not, I'll call on Jonathan.
Go ahead.
All right, Jonathan, go for it.
Anton, thanks for the talk today. Very interesting. I had one comment because I tend to see this a lot, that I've been trying to understand kind of the Southern viewpoint of history, because I think it's important as like a species and, you know, really to raise the consciousness of how other people think and to understand that in order, in many ways, I think this is what Putin actually is great at, is it's about like idealism's kind of the enemy and, you know, in this moral framing of the Civil War and of history as kind of good versus evil, I do think it is kind of a limiting framework, because the Southern viewpoint, it wasn't necessary. I could make an argument that they would have gotten outcompeted by rising cost of slavery, would have just outcompeted that form of economics, basically. And plus you had a huge wave of immigration coming in from Europe. And so, you know, eventually these things might have just changed naturally. However, I just wanted to make that comment. But my question was kind of about I think the problem of the West and of the US is it's kind of tussling with these two different traditions, like metaphysic traditions, maybe, where you have like the Faustian man concept of you know, just this expansive impulse, this will to power, you know, this kind of thing to achieve greatness. And then you also have at the same time, this kind of more, you know, countryside, like the Tolkien, the Shire concept, where you have people that are very grounded to the land, you know, this is really the conflict too in the United States, where rural versus urban, although it's a little bit different than what it is in Europe. But anyway, what do you kind of think about that sort of conflict, like a much more metaphysical point of view, and that this is kind of maybe the myth is also, there's a problem with the myth too, you know, because you can see both these things kind of tussling with each other in the dialogue that we have about the state of you know, reality today.
Okay, well, the first part, what you said about the South would have been overwhelmed, that's perfectly true. But the problem is that they wouldn't accept that. And so they started early on to build up an empire by force to conquer parts of the United States and southern countries, to build up a slave empire and to build up the ability to crush the Republic, which was going to overwhelm them by the workings of natural law and economics, demographics, immigration, and so forth. It's if you do something that's for man's benefit, you're gonna get more and more powerful. And so
I understand that, but I will say the mine wars is one thing, you know, that came in the early 20th century. Like, that's actually, I think, a worse period of American history in some ways, because it was so brutal. And
I know, that's the first part of what you
know. Okay, yeah.
So the idea of the Tolkien, the Shire, the, you know, being close to the land, being short. This is not really in accord with man's history as a species. Every civilization has had really exciting advances. Sometimes maybe you could say they took time, but I'm not sure about that either. I think there were leaps in every culture. People did spectacular things in science all over the world. And this goes way back. So man is a species that is ambitious and has a sense of humor and wants to know something that's forbidden to him. Now, on the other side, the impulse to be a giant. Again, let's look at this term manifest destiny. Matt has used this term in his writings. And I am cautious about this, because there were two ideas about developing the West. That's what Manifest Destiny was about, expanding the United States. One idea was to conquer the West, and that might have included conquering Mexico. It was an idea about, some of them had the idea of conquering nature. And the worst of that was a very shallow idea about simply grabbing something to get some money out of it. That's the worst aspect, and also to overpower people that were weaker. All right, that was the sense in which the term manifest destiny was used by what was called the Young America movement in the 1840s. And these were people involved with the Southern Empire approach, the Knights of the Golden Circle, and these kind of people. They were imperialists. Their own empire was to grab things on behalf of slavery. And they wanted the slave owners and their friends to run the United States and use the U.S. for that purpose. The other idea was that the westward development was to be done gradually, with the use of cheap prices for land and cheap mortgages, and with setting up towns and cities as you went, and educational institutions. It was good relations with the Indians. It was sisterly relations with Mexico and with the nations of Asia as well. When you reach,
when was that? Where was it?
That was interspersed with the other one. In other words, Lincoln sent an ambassador to China who basically revoked the treaty that was prejudicial to China that was put in under these scoundrel presidents like Tyler and Polk. they were working with in league with the British Empire and subduing China. And Lincoln sent Burlingame there to make an equal relationship between the U.S. and China and to start Chinese immigration to the United States, countering anti-Chinese racism in the United States. That was Lincoln's idea. He had very good relations with the Mexican leaders, the fight against the British-French invasion. He was on good terms with every country. And so the idea of developing, Colorado was developed along these lines by this guy, William Jackson Palmer. I'm going to have a whole chapter about him. But this is the idea of the harmony of interests between all humanity and between sectors of our economy. This is a more mature idea. It's a more successful economic idea and philosophical idea than the other one. To say that America advanced and made progress and got rich by the conquest idea, the conquest emotion and the conquest ambition is fraud, that's totally fraudulent. Because throughout our history, those who had that way of thinking and that way of greed were always involved with efforts to restrict the government and national ambitions for the progress of mankind. They were always involved in imperialism to crush national sovereignty, and the U.S. advanced by national sovereignty. Now, you know, this is a complicated thing. The British Empire is in some sense based on British chauvinism, isn't it? Right, and it's a racial thing as well. They set up racial hierarchies all over the world. Mm-hmm. You know, are you white enough to be in the upper class of Britain? Irish people aren't even white by that token, right?
Right.
Yeah. So, but it's conflating two different things. You can be a patriot of a country in a positive sense if the country's intentions and its actions are for the benefit of the people of your country and in accord with man's nature, man's higher nature. It comes down to what you think is the nature of man. Lincoln expresses this explicitly in his speeches. Lincoln is a gentle man. He's also horrified by war, which how do you get that from somebody who's leading the bloodiest war in our history? Same thing with Franklin Roosevelt. Same thing with George Washington, who led 8 years of bloody war, right?
America's a paradox.
It's a total paradox. This involves the conscience that hates killing, but it's also this same paradox of power that is best expressed by what you brought up, which is how did a country that is viewed as aggressive for its own ambitions, how did it succeed in providing a better life for its own people? Some people would say it never did that. There wasn't a better life. Some people would simply focus on those who were left out or destroyed, like the American Indians or the slaves. There's paradoxes in all of this. The radical abolitionists in New England who were free trade advocates and often in league with British ambitions gave up as soon as the war was over and abandoned the Black people of the South to the Ku Klux Klan, washed their hands of the whole thing. What was that Ku Klux Klan? weren't they opposed? Wasn't the South, when you had the power of terrorists like that? And there were terrorists like that before the war also. Aren't these people anti-national? That's the whole point of it. They're murderers against the American nation. Lincoln was murdered by these people. So was Kennedy. Same thing.
Yes, I mean, Wilson, that was also, I think the Wilson era was probably the most destructive, but that's my opinion.
It was, but Teddy Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson both were part of this, and the people that they're neither one of them is the master strategist. Teddy Roosevelt is a child in many ways, and Woodrow Wilson is posing, you know, and he thinks of himself as an idealist. He's a Southerner. He's raised in the Southern, you know, tradition, and he wants to be thought of as an idealist. And he denounces the bankers and people that are, you know, trying to, you know, wreck civilization. Really, they're both aware of these things. They're in the middle of it.
Yeah.
You know, Teddy Roosevelt, think about this, and to answer this thing about is the American expansion and progress, the real progress of America, is that based on the crime of aggression? Well, Teddy Roosevelt is the main big guy for aggression against South America and war. He loves war, right? Mm-hmm. The what do you call it? The Panama Canal is a triumph of engineering, but it is a shame of Morganeering. That is, the Morgan interests and Teddy Roosevelt together crushed Latin America while building this canal. Of course, they didn't build it. The engineers and the workers built it. Teddy Roosevelt, we were trying to get that built with cooperation of Colombia. Teddy Roosevelt took over by his, you know, the murder of the president, cut off the negotiations and staged a revolt in Colombia and stole Panama and did it against South America. But if you think about who Teddy Roosevelt was, he was instructed by his uncle in the strategy of the world. He edited his uncle's papers. He's in exile in England. His name was James Bullock. He was the head of the Confederate Secret Service in England, operating in England. And this American patriot, Dudley, who's in with Lincoln and Carey, was the counterpart. He was the Union spy leader in England, trying to spy on what Bullock was doing to get warships for the South. Bullock sent from England $30,000 to Canada for the crew that worked with and instructed Booth, who went up there and was sent back to attack Lincoln. That money for that crew came from Bullock from England, from Teddy Roosevelt's uncle. Teddy Roosevelt went to England and edited the papers with Bullock after the war was over, after Lincoln was dead, and to try to keep that out of, you know, publication. He never was able to come back. And the best biography of Bullock says, well, the reason was because he was involved with the Lincoln assassination. That's Teddy Roosevelt's background, as well as the filibusters from the 1850s. So he did this war against Spain in the 1890s. Same idea: conquer Spain, conquer Cuba, conquer Puerto Rico, conquer the Philippines, conquest. But what is his tradition? These are the people who hated the advancement of the United States. It was going to crush their way of life, the Southern way of life. The Southern, what do you mean the Southern way of life? Wasn't George Washington a Southerner? Yeah, he didn't like that way of life. He believed in farming, but he wanted to have a better way of life in the future. That's the American idea. So this concept of the aggressive conquest as being the Yankee idea. Sorry, that's just something that comes out of this axis of Wall Street, London, and the South, and then universities later on, who say that's your only choice. You can be a little dwarf in the hedgerows, and stick to your own business, tending your garden, or you can be a big shot in the world by conquering other people and exercising power and bullying them. There is no such thing as man in the image of God and aspiring to the heavens. It doesn't exist to them.
Those are very, very powerful closing words, Anton. I'm very glad that we ended with Jonathan's question and your final thoughts. That was great. Thank you, Anton. Thank you, everyone, for taking the time. And next Sunday, just so people know, it'll be a presentation on something within Ireland that has given British imperialists a headache for a long time. So we're going to deal with Ireland versus Malthus. John Amon's very happy about that. And that'll
we'll see you later.
Hope everyone can be there. Thank you, Anton. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Bye.